This is The Allusionist, in which I, Helen Zaltzman, fly language to the moon and let language play among the stars, then call language in because it's dinner time. Today we're going on a journey to space, 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 without taking a single step. Content note: there are mentions of ancient Greek and Roman deities and their terrible sexual behaviours and violent vengeance. Also, brace yourself for one category B swear and one category C swear, the kind of swears you might encounter in a fairly mainstream sitcom, or that you might use with your colleagues about your boss, but not to your boss. Before that, now would be a great time to sign up to join the Allusiverse. Go to theallusionist.org/donate, and for as little as $2 per month, you support this independent podcast during these current precarious times for media and entertainment, independent and not. And you get fortnightly live streams, which include soothing dictionary readings, and you get the company of your fellow Allusionauts in the lively and nurturing Allusiverse Discord community. And in a limited time offer, you can submit words and phrases that you would like me to record for you to use as your phone text tone, or alarm, or doorbell, or little message of affirmation. Sign up to The Allusionverse at theallusionist.org/donate by the 31st of August 2023 to get your choice of me shouting you awake in the morning. On with the show. Have you ever wondered, why are the planets in our solar system all named after Roman deities, except for two of them? One of those two exceptions is Earth, which means, well, Earth. And it doesn't fit the system because it wasn't formally discovered by humans. It was where they already were. So when they started identifying planets thousands of years ago, they hadn't yet counted Earth as one. And the other exception is Uranus. So let's go through them in turn. Mercury, named after the ancient Roman speedy messenger god, because it looks like it's moving really quickly, orbits the sun in just 88 Earth days. Next is Venus, the brightest planet, so they named it after the Roman goddess of love. Then there's Earth, named after that thing that we're sitting on. Then Mars, because it's red, and red is angry, like the god of war Mars. Then there's dad of Mars, Jupiter, and Jupiter's the biggest planet in the solar system, so they thought it fitting to name it after the king of the gods. And then there's Saturn, dad of Jupiter, then Uranus, more on him anon, then Neptune, which is bluish, so named after the god of the sea, and Pluto was named after the god of the underworld in 1930 by an English 11-year-old Venetia Burnley, whose granddad knew someone in the planet biz. Pluto was named the year before the Disney dog of the same name. I don't even want to get into whether Pluto counts as a planet or not, because I want to talk about Uranus. Do you pronounce it Uranus or Uranus? Because I was raised on Uranus. Then in the 1990s, it seemed like people were really trying to get Uranus to take off. But I think Uranus seems to have prevailed. And Uranus is a pretty cool planet. Well, it's a pretty cold planet, coldest in the solar system. It's the only planet to roll like a ball rather than spin around. Scientists think that on Uranus, it rains diamonds. Huge diamonds, millions of carats, bigger than bears. Bears is the unit of measurement on Uranus. Uranus has at least 13 rings and at least 27 moons. Uranus is 4 times wider than Earth. Uranus is very windy, up to 900 kilometers per hour. Uranus means the rainmaker, from a root word that means rain or moisture, also crops up in the Sanskrit for rain and the Greek for urine. Uranus has got a lot going for it, really. Except its name is a little tricky. This is a song for Uranus. Pronouncing it is dangerous. Some say Uranus. Is that better? Or does it just sound wetter? He's the god of rain, not the god of piss. Why does everyone take the mickey? No other planets endure this, being a bumhole or a whiz. Although Uranus is a ringed planet covered in methane and ammonia, so it does really lend itself to bumhole and whiz, sorry. Uranus was the first planet discovered with a telescope. It was too far for the naked eye to tell that it's a planet, not a star. Astronomer William Herschel is credited with discovering Uranus in 1781. Other people had noticed Uranus before, quite a lot of them actually, over the previous 2,000 years. But it's William Herschel who gets the credit, somehow, even though he thought it was a comet.
Oh look, a comet!
And he wrote about it to fellow astronomer Neville Maskelyne, who said,
"Well, do you see a tail on it, William? No! If it's orbiting the sun like a planet, and doesn't have a tail on it like a planet, it's probably a planet."
Nevertheless, Herschel was like,
"Nah, comet, 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 comet."
But other astronomers carried on studying this planet like it was a planet, so a couple of years later, Herschel was like,
"Okay, fine, it's a planet."
William Herschel wanted to name it George's Star, after George III, King of Great Britain and Ireland, who's already a king. There's loads of stuff named after him. And star is not even accurate for a planet. Herschel really was not doing his best work, was he? Although he did supposedly coin the term asteroid. Why was William Herschel so hot for King George III when he hadn't even seen Hamilton? Well, he wanted to name the planet after his boss. King George had appointed William Herschel court astronomer and offered him £200 a year to relocate to the town of Windsor so the king could look through the telescopes whenever he wants. That is the equivalent of a modern day £24,000 a year to uproot your whole life to be the king's 24/7 telescope bitch. What an offer. I'll give you less than the modern equivalent of the average national salary in Britain. To move where I am, live in my orbit, and you let me use your telescopes whenever I want. You are welcome, for I am the sun.
You are the sun.
And you are the earth. No, wait, I want to be the earth. I am the earth.
You are the earth.
And you are the moon. No, wait, I want to be the moon. It's so shiny.
Fine, you are the moon.
I am the moon, and the earth, and the sun. And you are a speck of dust orbiting me. Give me your telescopes.
What, all my telescopes?
Yes, because I want them.
But you're rich enough to buy your own telescopes.
Well, that's not the point.
It's never the point.
That is never the point. Other astronomers thought, rightly, that naming a planet after King George III was a bit Anglo-centric. Hmm, really? It's already pretty Eurocentric that the planet names are mostly Roman deities. A lot of other cultures, not all, but a lot, just translated them into their languages. Eventually, the astronomer Johann Bode suggested naming this planet Uranus, because planet naming is a dynasty for the planets further from the sun than Earth. There's Mars, then Mars's dad Jupiter, then Jupiter's dad Saturn, then Saturn's dad is Kylos. Why did Bode not go for Kylos? To give us this gift? He opted for the ancient Greek equivalent of Saturn's father, whose name was Uranus, and it got Latinized as Uranus. So who would be next in this system? Who's Uranus's parent? Supposedly Gaia, who is Earth, which messes up the planet family order, because Earth is already taken, way up the solar system. Uranus also had children with Gaia, so it's really just best not to keep looking into that family tree. This is a song for Uranus. For a long time it was nameless, George's star. Well, wow, no thank you. Don't just name it after your boss, you sycophant, you. Other astronomers suggested naming it Herschel, or he doesn't deserve it.
Comet wanker!
But no, it's Uranus, big daddy of the Greek gods. Uranus had a complicated family life. The Greek gods so often seem to have incredibly toxic relationships. And he was a really shit dad. Uranus was an absolute arsehole. Every night, the sky, which was of course him, would cover the earth, which was Gaia. Cover means sex times for ancient gods. Gaia and Uranus had a lot of children together, at least 18, including 3 Cyclopses, 12 Titans, and 3 Hecatonchires, who were giants with 100 hands each. But Uranus hated all of his children. Every time Gaia gave birth to another one, Uranus would take the child and hide them somewhere. Ah, mate, a lot of people don't enjoy spending time with their own children, but that's one of the risks you're signing up for by having them. After 18 children, Gaia finally got terminally pissed off at Uranus. She made a sharp sickle out of adamantine and gave it to her sons and asked them to go and castrate their father. Those poor kids, their mother, who is also their grandmother, asked them to maim their absentee father. The ancient Greek gods haven't had as much traction with worshippers during the last couple of millennia, and hopefully it's because they're all off having therapy. Only one of Gaia's children was willing to do it, the youngest titan, Cronos. He castrated Uranus and threw the testicles into the sea. And guess what? Uranus's blood and amputated testicles begat yet more children. From the testicles came forth Urania Aphrodite, and from the blood were born the giants, the Astrea nymphs, and the Furies. Yeah, the goddesses of vengeance. Uranus didn't come down to Earth anymore after that, if you're ever wondering how the sky and the Earth broke up. This is a song for Uranus. His story is outrageous. By his son he was castrated, testicles defenestrated into the sea, where they begat yet more kids. Imagine that. Giants, nymphs and furies, all from a detached set of ghoulies. We're just going to take a quick break for ads. The Allusionist is sponsored by Catan, the sociable board game of building and trading on an uninhabited island. Catan is available in more than 40 languages, and the game is endlessly varied because you can configure the hexagonal tiled board in infinite different ways. Well, I say infinite. Other people who are better at math than I am have calculated that there are some 20,369,349,000 different configurations, so not infinite, but enough to keep you amused for a few million years. And then you've got all the expansion packs. Catan is a board game for 3 to 4 players aged 10 plus, although younger kids can play with initial adult guidance. Get Catan at catanshop.com/Allusionist. Listeners of this podcast get 10% off the original base game Catan by using the promo code Allusionist at checkout. The offer is not good on other Catan titles or merchandise, but get yourself that original base game. That is catanshop.com/Allusionist and use the promo code Allusionist at checkout. The Allusionist is sponsored by Squarespace. Your one-stop shop for building and running your own website. You can build your website using one of Squarespace's award-winningly designed templates. Or, if you want to go bespoke, but not so bespoke that you have to become fully trained in web design, you can make your own template with Squarespace Blueprint. It's a simple-seeming process, just 5 steps to choose your custom layout, colours and type styles. And while you're doing it, you can see a live preview of your site so you know what it will look like for real as you're making it. Now, I say the process is simple seeming. There are more than 1 billion design combinations available, but don't panic. Professor Squarespace is there to guide you through it all. Professor Squarespace just wants you to get your perfect custom website. Go to squarespace.com/allusionist for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, use the offer code Allusionist to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. That's squarespace.com/allusionist, offer code Allusionist. And now, back to the show.
Thank you for calling the Planet Naming Hotline. If you know the extension number you need, please say it now.
Uranus.
I'm sorry, that is not a valid extension number. Transferring you to the full menu. Please listen carefully to the following options. For planet naming, say 1. For constellations, say 2. For asteroids, say 3. For comets, say 4. For moon craters, say 5. For lost property, press the star key.
I want to name Uranus.
I'm sorry, that is not a valid selection. Please listen carefully to the following options. For planet naming, say 1.
1.
You have selected 1. Planet naming. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. You would like to name a planet. First, please check that what you think is a planet is not actually a comet.
Yes.
Does the planet you wish to name have a tail?
Mm-hmm.
If you're not sure, comet is derived from the ancient Greek for long hair. Does your planet look like it has hair?
Uranus has hair.
If it has hair, it sounds like you're trying to name a comet. Please hold while we transfer you to the comet department.
No.
You've reached the comet naming department. What comet did you want to name?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm here by mistake. Can you transfer me back to the planet naming department?
Oh, did you get sent here because you said Uranus has hair?
No.
But did you, though?
Yes. Oh, God.
Thank you for calling the Planet Naming Hotline. If you know the extension number you need, please say it now. I'm sorry, that is not a valid extension number. Transferring you to the full menu. Please listen carefully to the following options. For planet naming, say 1.
One.
For constellations, say 2. You have selected 1. Planet naming. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. You would like to name a planet. First, please check that what you think is a planet is not actually a comet.
It's not a comet. It's not a comet.
Okay. You have confirmed it is not a comet. Now check that what you think is a planet is not just a blob of dirt on your telescope lens. Is it a blob of dirt on your telescope lens? If yes,
there's
say
dirt
1.
On Uranus.
If no, I'm sorry. I didn't catch that.
Uranus is dirty.
I'm sorry. I didn't catch that.
I said Uranus is dirty.
No, it's fine. I can guess. If your planet is a blob of dirt on your telescope lens, please say 1. If
2.
Your planet is not a blob of dirt on your telescope lens,
2.
Please say 2.
2.
Okay, you have confirmed your planet is not a blob of dirt on your telescope lens.
You're a blob of dirt.
To ensure your planet meets the 2006 definition, as specified by the International Astronomical Union, or IAU, please confirm whether your planet travels in an orbit.
How do I?
An orbit is a circular or elliptical path of travel around a focal point, in the planet's case, the sun or other star.
I can check.
Not to be confused with the orbit that is the bones housing your eye.
Okay.
If your planet fits in your eye hole, it's too small to meet the criteria of planet.
Okay, then. It's a big planet. Big, huge planet.
Does your planet fit in your eye hole? If yes, say 1.
No.
If no,
2.
Say
no.
2.
2.
Is your planet's orbit eccentric?
Uranus is eccentric.
Meaning the star it travels around is not at the centre of the orbit, which is what the word eccentric originally referred to. Eccentric, out of the centre, like the Greek ekkentros.
1.
Okay. To ensure your planet meets the 2006 definition of planet as specified by the International Astronomical Union, or IAU, please confirm whether your planet is round. If it is round, say 1.
Uranus is round.
Say
Uranus is round.
To ensure your planet meets the 2006 definition of planet as specified by the International Astronomical Union, or IAU, please confirm whether it has achieved dynamical dominance.
What?
Also known as clearing the neighbourhood. Is your planet the dominant object in its orbital zone?
Ooh, dominate my orbital zone, mate.
I'm sorry, that is not a valid response. Is your planet the dominant object in its orbital zone, other than its own satellites?
I don't know. What?
Is your planet the Billy Big Balls in the galactic playground?
Yes.
Okay, You have confirmed your planet is a planet per the definition of planet established in 2006 by the Planet Definition Committee, or PDC, of the International Astronomical Union, or IAU. Mm-hmm. Have you submitted your suggested name for your planet to the relevant task force of the Working Group for Planetary System Nomenclature, or WGPSN, part of the International Astronomical Union, or IAU, founded in 1919 to foster international cooperation and collaboration in astronomy and to avoid duplicate names of astronomical objects or any silly or obscene names before the names become planet official. All planet names must be approved by the Working Group for Planetary System Nomenclature, or WGPSN. Have you had your name approved by the Working Group for Planetary System Nomenclature, or WGPSN?
I can just go online now and submit it.
The approval process takes several months minimum.
Okay, then yes, I have had the name approved.
Are you sure?
Definitely.
Okay. What name do you want to give to your planet?
Uranus!
Speak after the tone.
Uranus! Uranus!
I'm sorry, there's already a planet called Uranus. The International Astronomical Union, or IAU, forbids duplicate planet names. What name that is not Uranus did you want to give to your planet? I'm sorry, I did not hear your answer. What name do you want to give your planet that isn't Uranus? Or Uranus McUranus face?
No.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
I don't know, I'm sorry.
Did you just call to say the word Uranus? If the answer is yes, say 1. If the answer is no, say 2.
2?
Are you lying? If the answer is yes, say 1. If the answer is no, say 2.
1.
Did you just call to say the word Uranus? If the answer is yes, say 1. If the answer is no, say 2.
1.
Do you still want to say the word Uranus? If the answer is yes, say 1. If the answer is no, say 2.
2.
Do you promise never to do this again? If the answer is yes, say 1. If the answer is no, say 2.
1. 1.
Thank you. Goodbye.
This episode is sponsored by HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. Pre-portioned, farm-fresh ingredients and seasonal recipes delivered right to your door in recyclable packaging. There are lots of options to choose from on HelloFresh, including vegetarian and vegan. They've got kid-suitable dishes and meals that are easy for seniors to prepare, lunches you can get done in just a few minutes, and snacks that you can add onto your order too. Hello, s'mores. Also, I think HelloFresh can be a nice thing to get as a gift for people who might need nourishment without hassle, like if they're recovering from a medical incident or busy with a new baby, or I find during mental health struggle times, shopping and choosing to look after myself are challenging, but less so if HelloFresh is like, look, we've done the thinking and choosing for you. Here are some pre-portioned ingredients, and here's how you add this thing to the other thing. There you go. Yes, you may eat it in bed. It's not our fault if you regret it tomorrow morning when you wake up with lettuce in your hair. Go to hellofresh.com/illusionist16, that's the digits 16, and use the code illusionist16, that's 16, for 16 free meals, that's 16, plus free shipping. That's HelloFresh.com/illusionist16, code illusionist16. The Illusionist is sponsored by Kitsch, who bring you products for your hair and skin, like hair towels and sleep bonnets and heat caps. They've got solid shampoos and conditioners, which is how I prefer my shampoos and conditioners, because they never leak in your luggage. And there's no plastic packaging, and you're not paying a premium for a bottle of what is mostly water. Solid all the way. Kitsch has got hair tools and ornaments. I'm coveting one of their Diamante hair clips that says feelings. And they have a whole new line of products in collaboration with Barbie to get your head ready for the cinematic event of 2023, including hair clips, heatless curlers, and satin pillowcases. Right now, Kitsch is offering you 30% off your entire order at mykitsch.com/illusionist. That's right, 30% off anything and everything, including feelings, at mykitsch, spelled mykitsch.com/illusionist. One more time, mykitsch.com/illusionist for 30% off your order. Hark back to the podlingual episode of this show, wherein James Kim talked about making fiction podcasts in multiple languages, English and Korean in his case. Back then, he was talking about his exquisite semi-autobiographical series Moonface, which I very much recommend, as I do his new project You Feeling This, a fiction podcast mixtape set in Los Angeles. Like Moonface, it's very beautiful and emotional and sounds amazing. And it's out in the pod places on the 27th of June, so go add You Feeling This to your playlists. The Illusionist will be taking a break in July to gather more grist for the pod mill, but while the show is on a break, the Illusiverse will still be busy. We've got our fortnightly live streams, we've got watch-alongs, the next one is Little Shop of Horrors, the 1986 musical. We've got Creative Sharing Club, where people talk about their creative projects, and of course we're going to have your personal text tones slash alarms recorded by me. So join us via theillusionist.org/donate for as little as $2 American a month, and the podcast itself will be back in the second week of August. Your randomly selected word from the dictionary today is a port, noun, an object produced supposedly by occult means at a séance. Origin 19th century, from French, apport, something brought, from apporter, bring to. Try using apport in an email today. This episode was produced by me, Helen Zaltzman, with Martin Austwick, who composed and played the music and also played William Herschel and provided backing vocals and editorial advice. Find Martin's music at palebirdmusic.com. Our ad partner is Multitude. If you have a product or thing about which you'd like me to talk, sponsor the show. Contact Multitude at multitude.productions/ads. Seek out Allusionist Show on YouTube, Instagram, Facebook and Twitter, and you can hear or read every episode, find links to more information about the topics and people therein, donate to the show and become a member of the Illusiverse, and see the full dictionary entries for the randomly selected words, all at the show's forever home, theillusionist.org.